Hello. Thank you for being here today in one more webinar from Moodle Academy. Today's webinar is about MoodleNet and MoodleNet for developers, particularly. And today with us, it's Alessandro Giasanti, who is the MoodleNet backend developer, and Paul Hodgson, the MoodleNet product manager. Paul, would you like us to give an overview?
Hello, everyone. I'm not going to take too much of your time. This is really Alessandro's webinar. Just to give you a little bit of background information, it's been just over a year since we released the latest version of MoodleNet, and we've had lots of requests from developers about how they can adapt MoodleNet for their own use. And Alessandro and the team have been doing a lot of work in the last few months to enable this, to restructure MoodleNet and to enable packages to be written. So what we're going to go through today is essentially a development environment, the architecture that it's based upon, and how to create and test packages. So then I'll come back at the end and talk about how you can contribute and accessible development practice in the future. But for now, I'll pass you over to the very capable hands of Alessandro. Alessandro, take it from here.
Yeah, thank you, Paul, and hello, everyone, and thank you for joining. I'm Alessandro Giasanti, you heard. I'm a developer for Moodle at Moodle for MoodleNet project. And yes, today we'll have a webinar to introduce the interested developers around the globe on how we refactored the MoodleNet version 2 and how we are refactoring it and to enable customization and enable developers to develop packages to extend and customize MoodleNet.
Alessandro, can you share your screen?
Oh, yes, I will share your screen now, sure. And we will start directly from the development environment for MoodleNet. Development environment actually is just about having a good IDE for developing in JavaScript, or we recommend TypeScript, as the software is written in TypeScript. JavaScript is also supported. So we need actually Node.js in the environment, in our local machine, and in production also when we want to install it. And ArangoDB instance service running. ArangoDB is the database of choice of MoodleNet. So it's the main database and currently the only one that is needed for running the MoodleNet. We're going to use VS Code as the editor, as a preferred editor, because it has very good support for TypeScript. And we're going to use Docker for deploying the needed ArangoDB instance, but you can have it running however you like. So the best way to develop for the moment, the best way to develop a custom package for MoodleNet is starting from our project repository. Okay, first, maybe I should talk about some terminology. We will talk about packages and extensions. And when we talk about packages and the extension, in some way, we're talking about the same thing. Packages, we say packages because packages are the standard, are standard NPM packages, as any library that you can find on npm.org, for instance, for JavaScript. And those packages, this is how extension, custom functionalities, and new functionalities for MoodleNet would be delivered and published. So we talk about packages because we will develop extensions for MoodleNet in packages, you know, in JavaScript packages. Typically, we will use extension term mostly from the user point of view, because user admins, when they will want to install new extension using the admin page, they will talk about extension, not packages. So We can start by having cloning the repository of the project, which is this one. We can just start use issue a couple of command yarn at the root folder project, project folder, and then yarn init dev to initialize the project to start to have it ready to develop. I actually did already all this stuff because it would take some time, you know, some time to install all the dependency as usual with when we talk about project with a bunch of JavaScript dependencies. Moreover, so I already done all the initialization of the development environment. The first thing we can do here after initializing, after having initialized the development environment, we can, well, see how it works. We can start a development, a development backend. We can install a development backend in the development environment and start it with these two commands. We can do it here. So I launch a terminal inside the MoodleNet project. Here we are. This is the MoodleNet project, the repository, the cloned repository. And we can issue this yarn dev install VM in my dev. My dev is just a name, is a custom name that you can choose. It could be whatever. It's just the name of the directory in which the dev backend will be installed. And let's see what happened. Our development environment always install these development backends inside this directory, .devmachine. So we now have this mydev, which is the name that we choose it here, a mydev directory with an installation of MoodleNet. And we now can start it with issuing the command yarn dev backend, always passing the same the name of the directory, of the installation directory we choose. We can have many installation directory, maybe with different configurations if we need to test different configurations. So we can yarn dev backend my dev. Okay, here we are. Oh, sorry, I forgot something. I actually have to first, as I am saying here, we have to ensure that ArangoDB is running on localhost. So I will run it with this, with Docker inside a Docker container, because it's quite handy for us to have it in Docker. But I'm going to run it here. Now I'm running a complete empty Arango database. And let's step in a little and just a moment into the Arango database interface. We can see how is on localhost on port 8529. And we have a nice UI that ships with ArangoDB and see what's happening in there. We can see that we have an instance running, but we don't have any database inside of it. Now, as said, as we tried before, we can start the development backend that we installed. And while it starts, we can watch what's happening even in this database. Okay, first run will ensure that all the system packages are installed, so it takes just a couple of seconds. Now it's starting all the core packages that will give the most important features for MoodleNet. If you go here and just refresh the page, we will see that we're the system is creating some packages with some strange names, if you see, but we will get to it later and you will understand better what's happening here. For the moment, we have three databases. The system now is hanging because needs some cryptographic keys, and it's creating them now, and it takes just a while. That's for the first launch. And meanwhile, it's starting. Well, it's almost ready. It takes just a couple of minutes the first time. But I would like to jump to and have a look on how is the MoodleNet architecture. So MoodleNet architecture is, well, the software stack is very simple because the whole software is built from backend to frontend, all in JavaScript, well, actually TypeScript. And the whole code base is in TypeScript. And so we have our code base will run in two different environments, in two different platforms. On the backend, it will run on Node.js, and on the frontend, obviously on browsers, on any modern browser. I would say also that actually the JavaScript is completely full stack from the backend to the browser, because actually ArangoDB is a database that is a JSON database, and it even the query language is resemble very much JavaScript. It looks very much JavaScript, and it stores data in JSON format. On Node.js, the code base is npm packages. Every functionality, each functionality or each set of functionality of the system are encapsulated in an independent npm package. The other thing to keep in mind, and the other feature of the system, and it's a must for the moment, is that we support for the moment only the new ECMAScript modules from Node.js and from JavaScript, for latest ECMAScript versions. We may support legacy modules, but for the moment we just support ECMAScript modules. While on browsers, the main technology that we use is React 18 and all the stuff that comes with it, like HTML, CSS5, CSS3, and whatever other library that could be useful. So software architecture. As said, every function, every functionality is is implemented in an isolated package. So the core main MoodleNet is comprised of a number of packages. At the moment, we have all those packages that sets up a standard installation on MoodleNet. Of core. The core package is the fundamental package that lets the whole framework function. And it's about keeping all together all the functionality packages. So we have a bunch of fundamental packages, the authentication manager, direct application, content graph, we will talk about this. Other packages that give services like the MongoDB, cryptographic, email services. Other packages that are about content, other packages that have some implementation for authentication, yeah, and some utility packages. I won't go too much about the details because it will take too much time, but we will have some information about all the core packages that we have in a standard MoodleNet installation. Just a couple of words about the core. The core keeps together all the functional packages and mediate the communication between them. It manages the boot sequence and the installation, the upgrade, the uninstallation and the upgrade of the packages of the system. Then we have ArangoDB that just manages the Arango database instance. And then we have Authentication Manager that manages users centralized APIs, with centralized functions. An HTTP server, an extensible HTTP server. Must say that most of the packages are extensible. Then we have the React application based on React. This is also extensible. Then we have a content graph, which is the heart of MoodleNet, actually. Here, this uses ArangoDB and makes a database in the ArangoDB instance. And here, every package shares this database using the APIs of this package, content graph. And in this database, will be stored all the content. The content meaning all the content that web users will see on the web application. And so different packages with different functionalities will insist on this content graph package, extending it and making relation between different entities coming from different packages. So this is an overview of all the core packages that we have in our standard installation and how they are related in the system. What package uses or depends other package, how packages use other packages and how they depend to each other. So that's why versioning is for the packages is independent, but I wouldn't get too much into this now. It's more interesting to understand how to create a custom MoodleNet package. Let's see what's happening here. So the system is started now. We can see that after those databases, after Crypto has created his cryptographic keys, if we refresh, we see that we have other databases. Every package, every function package at on demand can ask the Arango database, ArangoDB package to install or create a private database for its own purposes. So we have a database for the organization package, another base for the email service package, another base for the authentication, and so on, for the content graph, and so on. So we have a bunch of databases now here running with some data on it, inside of it. So let's check what happened if we go, we have the server listening on port 8080. So we just jumped into localhost 8080, and we'll see MoodleNet running here. Yoo-hoo. Okay, at the moment, MoodleNet doesn't have many functionalities. At the moment, we you can see functionalities for all the framework for extending stuff in the for extending the React application and the backend, and all the functionalities for creating new user, for login and sign up. And so if we want to see something now for the moment, we have to, just join, create a new user. And at the moment we have just one, just one authentication method, which is the simple email authentication method. I mean, this is a package. It's called the simple email. You can see it here in the log. And this, it's a standard authentication and sign up method. You just provide an email and a password, and you have to confirm your email by a link that you get into your email. And that's all. Well, at the moment, I didn't configure an SMTP for the email service. So as a default, until we configure the email service SMTP, we just get a the link that should be sent to the signing up user and the link that confirmed the email. So for the moment, we can just copy it and confirm the email manually this way. But this would be should be a link. Okay, we created a new user now. That's the user that I created. I can see my profile. I can edit something and save whatever. And I can log out and log in again. And put some, okay, sorry. Okay, and log in again. Right. Authorization are not yet implemented. It's the first thing that we'll do from tomorrow. But now any sign up user can step into the setting page, for instance. Here we have the setting page. Setting page have some functionalities, some basic functionalities for changing the stuff that you see on the main page. Like we can change this one with a new title, Hello World, and say, yeah, simple stuff, nothing credible. Then the thing that is interesting for the moment for us is the extension section. Here we can see that we have, here we call it extension for the users, but we know that they are packages. We see all the packages that are installed and running on the system. And you can see that these are all the main package, all the core packages that we have here. To understand this, let's see a little, just for a little while, how does this installation directory look? We have a package JSON, and we see that the package JSON defines all the packages that will be installed in the system and will be run in the system. And you will see that these extensions are the same that you see here. In development, this points directly to the folders here, the development folders. In production, they would point to a npm registry endpoint, to an npm registry package. And we will see this later too. So let's see. Here in the slides, you can see there are a number of steps to make to develop a simple, very simple demonstration for a simple custom package. I won't go through all of this, but I will talk about all these steps in a much faster way. We can use, you see, in this package directory, we have all the core packages, but there is also another package, another directory, which is called My MoodleNet MJS Package Template. This is just a template, a very simple custom extension, custom package, that could be used as a reference to understand how things work here. So let's say that a package, a MoodleNet package for extending MoodleNet is just a simple standard npm package with its own package JSON. Here we have it with a name, it must be type module. As we said, we currently just support ESM modules. We need to support Node.js major equal 16, because this will support properly the ESM packages, ESM modules. And with an export, yeah, this is the maybe you are used with the main property of package JSON to define which is the main module. In ESM, it's better to use exports. It looks like the same. This is like, it works like the same. If you choose the point and you point to the the main module you have, it's just equal to the main property in standard package.json. And here we say that, a standard, typical MoodleNet package must have a dependency to a MoodleNet core, because the MoodleNet core is the fundamental hook to MoodleNet system. So you need to have a dependency to MoodleNet core in as a peer dependency. This, I won't get through this, the explanation of this now, because it's time consuming, but we have to declare all the dependency that we need from MoodleNet as from other MoodleNet packages in the peer dependency. For the moment, we are going to use the core, the React app, because we want to extend the React application too, and the component library, because maybe you want to use some component that are designed to be look good on our React application that has some design patterns. So let's see. First of all, we want to, well, before getting into the code, let's install it. Typically, on a production situation, you would have this section, install extension, and you would see here a list of compatible extension, the system would make a query to npm to the registry and check for extensions that are published there. But at the moment, there are none, so we don't have any compatible extension on npm. But for development, we have the possibility to install an extension from our local directory. To have this option enabled, we have to go to advanced, set the UI in developer mode, and here in the install extension, we will have also this option from local package. We can copy the path of this package folder, paste it here, and say, we'll open also here the log of the backend and install it. What will happen now? The system will install the package, this package, in the system and restart the system and reboot all the packages. We have the system restarted now. And if we check out here somewhere in the log, we should see somewhere, here is the system is importing and connecting my MoodleNet MJS package template. This is the thing that we just installed. Let's see what happened here on the installation directory. On the installation directory in the package.json, we see that we have a new package installed in the dependencies. Here we see all the set of packages and functionalities that are running in the system. This is a new one, the new entry. Now let's see. How does it work? Let's see how is the code how did we develop this package? First thing to say is that the boot sequence will import the main module of the package. So it will import this one in this case. Let's go and see it, main MJS. And we see that there are a bunch of things going on here. Well, first thing to do is to import some functions for MoodleNet core, because we want to hook into MoodleNet, into the MoodleNet core, into the system. And the first thing to do is to connect this package. So we can use this function connect package. We pass the import meta. This is also something that I want to get into the whys here and into the because. And we say that we want to connect this package and we want to provide some APIs for this package. We will get into the APIs later, just in a while. Then I say that I want to use also the React application because I want to extend this too. So I get a reference to this, importing it. And I ask the MoodleNet core to use this package. Now I can use this reference, this given by the core to the React app, and I can call the plugin API in React package. And I'm telling to React package, look, I want to extend React application, and I want to extend it, and I will give it an entry point for my extension, for my React app extensions. And I will give a path to this entry point, main component JSX, which is stored in SRC web app main component JSX. Here it is. We will go through this just in a minute. Let's see the APIs. I'm saying that my package wants to publish some APIs. APIs is the API definition is just an object, a structured object, and where each leaf of this object is a definition of an API. So we have an API here that is inside a structure of as hello and world. This is a hierarchy. And the API is just a simple function that takes some parameters and returns a promise of something. That's all. I get parameters and I return a promise. Well, I return with async or however you want to do it, but it must return a promise. And it gets as a first, as a queried parameter, a context. Let's see how it works. And it provides also a simple function that should validate the parameters that should be passed to the API. So here we want to ensure that the first parameter is a string and the second parameter is a number. And we can return something to that tells the system that parameters are okay. Let's see. By default, the system will HTTP, the HTTP package, HTTP server package will publish the APIs the package APIs through at HTTP. So we can see that we can already use these APIs, the API that we have defined here, by a post call to 8080.APIs, my MoodleNet. Here we have a prefix that is the package name, the version, and then the path to the API that we want. So in this case, hello world, then we pass the args, and let's say that we pass two strings instead of a string and a number. If we call it, I get a validation failure from here, saying that I'm passing bad params. If I pass the right params, formal valid params, I get a response from here. So I get a message, the param that I sends, and just a taste of what you can find in the context. For instance, in the context, you can find who called this API. In this case, is the HTTP server that called the API. I mean, when I say the caller, with what package called this API? You would find also information about the user, the original user that issued the call, and other relevant information. Let's see what happened on the front end now, on here. You won't see much here because meanwhile we are talking, the system restarted and the web application recompiled with the new stuff coming from the custom package. So if we now refresh the page, we see some different. Okay, we see a link here. And I see that it's a new page came here. And this page, it looks like it is using the API of this new package. So what happened here? Let's get into the main component that we registered for the React app. The main component is just a simple React component that will be injected into the React application. And here we can use some APIs from React App that are exposed to customize the interface. In this case, we are going to use three registers to register widget or add-ons for the React application. In this case, we are using user register for the routes because we want to add, here are my routes. I want to add a new route that will render the Hello World page. So I register these routes here and I want to add a write component with a link to my Hello World page. And I use this register, write component, and this avatar menu items, I will register something else here. Another piece of code is going to be just a link, always to the same page. So we can see that we have added a root because we have a new root here that wasn't present before. We have a link here. This is this link here, my page link, added on the right. And another element in the menu, my page. This is what the package have added in the web application. And here we can see also that how we could access the API of our package by using the library provided by React App. So we can just say my package.call hello world, which is the path of the API that we define it. We pass the string, the params, one string and a number. And then we get the response and set it here as a state. And then we simply, and we provide it with a context, with a React context, in such a way that Hello World page can render the API response that we for the call that we made on the main component. I mean, this is the main component that we register is the entry point for the web application extension. Here we can use all the APIs from other packages, core packages or other packages to extend them. And from now on, the whole implementation of the web application features for our package is just free. It's just, you can do it as you want. You're completely free to do this. You just want to use probably likely hooks to other packages features to add the widgets or add pages. Yeah. Once you've done this, you are completely free to implement your UI as you like. The same happens on the backend. Once you have hooked into into MoodleNet Core, well, you can use other packages to interact with them using the core APIs and core functionalities, but then you are completely free to implement your the functionalities of your package in the way that you like. In fact, in this we say that TypeScript, because the whole code base is completely and very strongly typed, even in the dynamic parts. So you have strong typings even when you call APIs from the web application. Everything is completely typed. But you can see that you can even write a package with standard JavaScript. Note that we are using MJS extensions because, as said, we are supporting only ESM modules, ECMAScript, the new features of ECMAScript modules. So let's see here. Let's go back to the setting page. And if we go to extension page, now we can see that we have a new guy that we install it. At the moment, any core package can't be installed, but new packages can. So we have installed this. Now we want to uninstall it. And again, we should see, if I click it in the right way, okay, that the system will restart after removing and uninstalling the package that we wanted to uninstall. As soon as the system restart, if we try to refresh the page, we won't see it by once. We still see my page and this stuff here because it takes a while to recompile the movements on this. It will take a couple of minutes now, maybe less, maybe more, it depends. But as soon as the application has been recompiled, we should see the application as the web application as it was before installing it. What more? Well, I think that's enough. I think we got through every step for the. I just want to see here the web application that has been. Well, it takes just a while, but that's all. We can get to question times, I think.
Thank you so much, Alessandro, for this.
Here we are. The application has recompiled and
perfect.
Yes. And the page that used to have some content is now not available. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Before we go to the questions, what about go through...
Yes. Okay, but we have something more. Yeah, actually.
Please go.
Yeah, sorry, I forgot one part. Let's say that we are happy with this package and we want to use it on our production environment. Well, now I'm in an empty directory and I just want to showcase how we can install a real MoodleNet installation. We just need some standard npm command npx, and we call @moodlenet/create, and we choose a folder, a destination folder, like my deployment. We, for the moment, we have to This would point to the standard npm registry, npm.js.org, but we didn't publish yet. We have this published in our own private registry. You can check it out. We have a registry where we test this system now, and we have all these packages published here. You won't find them in npm. So if you want to install with this command, you have to add the registry option pointing to this URL. This will install MoodleNet 3.0 Alpha 10 in the destination folder that we choose it. It takes some time because it will install all the dependencies. We are also working for making this process much faster. And maybe we can go on with the webinar, with other things, and we can have a look at the end how to install the package that we deployed, that we developed inside a production-like environment as soon as this process is ready.
Thanks, Alan. Thanks, Alessandro. I noticed a question in the chat there. So just to talk about contributing packages to MoodleNet, I think it was Wen who asked if MoodleNet supported plugin development, and this is really this point. Just to ask a clarifying question, I'm assuming you don't mean, does MoodleNet accept Moodle LMS plugins? Because it doesn't. It's a completely different technology stack. But will we have a contribution and a plugin system? Yes, indeed we will. It will be redesigned to act like an app store that sits alongside MoodleNet through an NPM repository. But obviously, we're going to wait for some contributions before we do that. But yes, absolutely, we will. So in the future, if you do develop something and you would like us to make it available to the community, then at the moment, just get in touch with us via Tracker or the community, and we will set up a way of looking at that, what you're doing, and supporting you on that and getting it out there for the community. And apart from that, this is going to just wait and see what we get. I know some of you, for example, are waiting on single sign-on packages to be added. I know that there are some people working with this externally already, so we will be offering those just as soon as those are ready. Next slide, please, Anna. And just a final note on, there's a link there into the accessible development practices that obviously the whole of Moodle trying to work towards. So if you are developing something, the code outputs are very important, that they are accessible, and we check accessibility on everything now. If you want to have a look, there's a link there to our accessible code and development practices course in case you want to check the standards we're working to. Just like to say thank you. And if there are any questions.
Oh, just a couple. I would like to answer a couple of questions from the chat that I saw.
Can you just allow me to read them through so we can have them in the recording as well? Starting from Geoffrey, who asked about MoodleNet is meant only for content creators or also for consumers. And Paul has already addressed this accurately, saying that MoodleNet is for anyone producing educational resources of any kind or sharing and curating resources. And if you are interested, there is another course in the educator pathway here in Moodle Academy, where you can see how MoodleNet is used, is meant to be used from the educator perspective. And we have a question from Sergio. He says that before releasing version 3, you will implement authorization. I can't update to a release with open settings to anyone, or am I wrong?
Yes, okay. I will answer to Sergio Rabellino. At the same time, I would answer to Stefano Robotta, is the second last one comment, because it's about the same topic. Yes, obviously there's no authorization pattern here. That's the first thing that we will implement from tomorrow, and we already designed it, and it will be surely on MoodleNet 3. That's for sure. The authorization, I can give some preview about the logic of the authorization system. It will it will resemble a little bit concepts from OAuth, meaning that it will be based on scopes. APIs will be assigned to scopes, and users will be also assigned to be able to access some scopes. So scopes will be the main strategy for managing the authorization of the API access of all packages access. So every package will be able to define its own scopes, and every package could also will be able to use other packages' scopes. So the scopes will be strings in some way that are prefixed with the package name, and at the end with package specific scope, defined scope.
Thank you. When also asked, and I think Paul already answered that, about MoodleNet support, if MoodleNet supports MoodleNet plugin development, and say that it's completely different products, AV says, can a plugin run as separate service on a different container?
Well, at the moment, we are focusing on the framework, on the system, on this architecture, and it's designed to work only as a singleton. But we will strongly need the possibility to install different a cluster of instances, and also we will need to clusterize the services in these instances, having kind of microservices, I wouldn't call it microservices, but a service-oriented architecture where some instance will be enabled to perform some services, but not others. So yeah, clusterize to have the IT administration have the control to split the workload between different services and between different instances. So it's not now, but this is something that we have in the roadmap for sure.
Okay. Sergio asks, which registry software have you installed, and if it's open source?
Okay, this is nice. I just found one that's working well. It's called Verdaccio. I will type it here
on the chat,
and maybe I can find also the, well, if you look it on Google, that's there, you will find it. Verdaccio.org, yes. And it works great. It has differences in some queries, in the response of some queries. So it's a bit difficult to have our implementation for supporting both NPM, standard NPM, and Verdaccio. We will try to have a system that will support both. Maybe we will have the system that will support both NPM standard and Verdaccio. We will strive to have this.
Okay. Dimitris, thanks you for the excellent presentation. Stefan, I think you already deal with that. Is there already a user role model implemented, or does every user have the same rights?
Yeah, I will extend the answer that I gave before. Having a scope based authorization system, user roles can be made up, assigning to different roles a set of scopes. Yes.
Okay. Sergio asks that should be faster to integrate an OIDC/AUTH2 external AUTH.
Yeah, it should be quite simple because we are taking our authorization system will resemble those specs.
Okay, when asked about the MoodleNet forum, to keep asking questions, and Paul has provided the official forum from the community forum from Moodle.org. And of course, you can still use the forums inside the course for things that can be dedicated to the presentation. And I guess that was all so far. That was quite interesting. Thank you so much. And just to for the conclusion, I would like to invite you to get involved in the growth of Moodle Academy by contributing to its development. You can suggest topic ideas, and you can go to the Get Involved course from the course main page, from the site main page, and suggest topics to be covered in the future. You can also contribute to webinars if you have some expertise on a subject, and of course you will receive a presenter's badge. And you can also contribute to course development, and of course again you will gain course builder badge. And you can also help us spread the word about Moodle Academy. You can tell your friends and colleagues about the courses offered here free in Moodle.academy. Everybody can earn a badge by completing a course. And even our current course, the MoodleNet for developers, will be further developed, and we will have a badge as well. And of course, do tell others about Moodle.academy. And if you have friends who are educators and not developers, there might be interest in the Moodle Educator certification. Thank you, Alessandro. Thank you, Paul, for being here. And thank you, all of you, for joining us in today's session.